Now, we're delighted to be joined by Professor Ted Melhuish today to deliver the keynote address for this forum. And I really feel a bit silly introducing him because almost everyone came up to him before we even start and said, "Oh, I'm so looking forward to hearing from you." But I'll do the right thing anyway. So Ted is a Professor of Human Development at Oxford University. He's been involved in studies that have directly contributed to social policy in the UK in areas of families with young children, early years services and education. That includes the universal provision of a preschool place for all 3- and 4-year-olds, as well as the establishment of 3,500 children's centres, the UK's Every Child Matters and 10-year childcare strategies. Ted's undertaken research across 12 countries influencing landmark legislation and childcare, early education, child poverty and parental support policies. He's sometimes a lightning rod for controversy as well, including advocating for Australia to make preschool free in order to ensure our nation competes economically with other developed countries. Though I have to say I'm not sure that that idea will find too much opposition with this audience today. Please welcome Professor Ted Melhuish.
Hello. Well, I would like to acknowledge the Kaurna people as the traditional owners of the land that we meet on today and wish to thank Michael O'Brien for his wonderful welcome to country. Also, may I thank the Premier of South Australia, the Honourable Jay Weatherall, for inviting me to Adelaide today and for the vision he has for children in South Australia and indeed the whole nation. May I also acknowledge my fellow speakers, the South Australian Minister for Education and Early Childhood Development, the Honourable Dr. Susan Close, Dr. Sarah Glover, the Director of the Mitchell Institute, and Sam Page, the Chief Executive Officer of Early Childhood Australia.
Okay.
Now, today I'm going to talk about early childhood education and care, to summarize all of those things that happened before school, involving childcare and early education, and the welfare of nations, because indeed the two things are very closely linked. Now, let's think about the context we find ourselves in today. The Australian Bureau of Statistics predicts that in 2061, the workforce will decrease by 15%, while the elderly will increase by 50%. A similar situation exists in most developed countries. So economic sustainability is going to require maximizing the capacity of the workforce and increasing productivity, else we're all going to have a drop in living standards. Also, the OECD reports that 20% of the populations in developed countries do not achieve the basic minimum skills for adequate functioning in modern societies, and the problem's twice as great for disadvantaged groups. And currently, 24% of Australian children are reported as entering school with developmental problems. And these disadvantaged groups have a variety of greater risks for poor health, social, emotional, behavioral problems, attention, cognitive, and language problems, which is obviously going to affect educational progress, literacy, numeracy, social skills, employability, health, adjustment, and criminality, which in turn will have big costs for society. So the impact of family disadvantage on well-being is well known. What is also apparent when you examine the literature is that the roots of the disadvantage that children have as they develop in disadvantaged circumstances lie in early childhood. And early experience is critical to the link between disadvantage and poor development. So we have two ways of looking at this problem and two arguments for investing in early childhood. One is a moral argument. We all should be doing what we can to enhance the well-being of everybody. Okay? But there's another argument, which is an economic one. When my neighbor commits a crime, I pay for it. When my neighbour is on benefits, I pay for those benefits. When my neighbour has a child who has special educational needs, I pay for that, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So we all pay for those issues, even though we may not directly suffer them ourselves. Now, this illustrates the situation in Australia with regard to disadvantage and outcomes. This is measures from the longitudinal study of Australia children. And here we have quintiles of parental income showing how at the start of school, both school readiness and vocabulary show a distinct change as we go up the income levels. Clearly illustrating the problems that children from poorer households will have. Now, as I said, the evidence indicates that early childhood is critical for longer-term development. And here are two quotes from two very well-known social scientists, Gösta Resping Anderson and James Heckman, who won the Nobel Prize for Economics in 1999. Now, while early childhood is clearly very important, it's only in the last decade or so, that people have started to acknowledge how important it is. And the consequence of that is historical sequence is that most countries do not spend as much on early childhood as they do on middle or later childhood. For example, Japan spends very little on early childhood and a lot more on middle and later childhood. On the other hand, if you go to the other end, the Scandinavian countries, Sweden, Iceland, Finland, the gap between what's spent on early childhood and later childhood is much less. Okay. There's also an association between spending on early childhood and child poverty rates. Those countries with the highest spending on early childhood, places like Denmark, Sweden, Norway, and so on, have very low child poverty. Other countries like Mexico and Poland, the USA, with low spending on early childhood, have very high poverty rates. So those things seem to go together. Now, I'm going to talk about the evidence with regard to the importance of the early years. I'm going to concentrate first on 0 to 3. And in doing so, I want to stress the importance of the child's language development, because the child's language development is going to underpin cognitive development, social development, and emotional development. And a child at age 3 who is behind in language is going to have problems later on unless we do something to bring that child up to a normal level of functioning. And we have the opportunity at age 3, but later on we will quickly lose that opportunity. Now, this is linked to brain development. Here's a very well-known graph from Charles Nelson, which plots the number of synapses in different areas of the brain at different ages. And let's look at the blue line. This is the number of synapses in the language area of the brain. And around 9 months, there's a peak in the number of synapses. And then they fall off to about 4 years of age. Now, when you see that, your first thought is, where most of the synapses are here. So this must be where most learning is taking place. No, it's not. The way the brain functions, it functions on the principle of use it or lose it. And so what happens is you have a huge potential for language learning here. The child could learn any language in the world, but only certain synapses will be reinforced by experience. And those will be the ones that are kept. The ones which aren't reinforced by experience will drop out. So this is where the learning is taking place in this fall-off period here, where the ones which are reinforced by experience are kept. So that's why these years here are so critical in language development. Now, we know that the environment that children are in is going to influence their language development. I'm going to illustrate that with two kinds of studies. One study about the home environment and one study about daycare environments. This is a study by Hart and Risley, two well-known American psychologists. And what they did is they placed a little button radio mic on the baby's clothing, had a recorder hidden in a cupboard in the home, which switched itself on and off at random periods during the day. So we have a selection of the child's language that is spoken to the child. And they then calculated how much language is being heard by the child. And they found that in a welfare home, where the families were living on welfare and extremely disadvantaged, there were only about 500 words an hour. In a working class home, around 1,200 words an hour. But in professional homes, like doctors, lawyers, that kind of thing, we have over 2,000 words an hour. But it's not just the sheer number of words that these children hear, which differs. It's the kind of words that get spoken to the children. So some of them were affirmations. Oh, that's nice. Let's do that again. Some of them were prohibitions. Stop that! Get out of here! Okay? And what we find, in the welfare homes, prohibitions predominate over affirmations. It's the reverse in the working class homes. And then what we see in the professional homes, a huge increase in affirmations. Now, they calculated that by the child's fourth birthday, the total number of words that these children would have heard is 12 million words in the children in welfare homes, 25 million words in the working class homes, and 42 million words in the professional homes. That is, there's a 30 million word gap between here and here. Now, if you give one child 30 million words more experience than another child, what's going to happen? Well, this is what happens. These are the children's vocabulary scores over the first 36 months. Clearly, the professional family's going here, working class family's here, and welfare family's here. And this gap just gets bigger and bigger as time goes on. So we see that the experiences of those children in those first 3 years are already producing distinct differences based upon their experiences in their home environments. But it's not just, I skipped these one around. It's not just home environments, it's daycare environments. For example, I studied with some colleagues in the 1980s, 255 children from birth to 6 years. And there were four groups in this study. They were all two-parent families, all having their first child, and they had to decide whether one of them would go back to work after the birth of the child or whether one of them would stay home and look after the child. And some of them decided a parent would stay home, almost always the mother, and the child would not have any non-parental care. Another group both returned to work, and they would use a grandmother or other relative for daycare. Another group used childminders for daycare. Another group used nurseries or group daycare. And we studied these children and their environments in some detail. And in particular, we looked at the interactional quality, the kinds of interactions and responsiveness in those interactions that took place in these different settings. And what we found was in the home environment, this is the lowest, this is the average, and this is the highest, this pattern. And then the relatives are fairly similar. But then the childminders show a big difference. The worst childminders had very low quality of interactions, but the best childminders had extremely high, huge range for childminders. In the nurseries in the 1980s, they were always lower than the other types of settings. Now, what we found in that study was regardless of which environment the children were in the daytime, the quality of interactions in that environment predicted later language development. So those children who had the best quality of environment showed the highest language development. And the quality of the environment, which is particularly important, was communications and responsiveness in interactions. And these effects persisted till 6 years of age when the study ran out of money. And we also found that stability of care was strongly associated with the quality of care. In fact, I'd go so far to say as, if you have an unstable workforce, it's virtually impossible to maintain high quality. The results from this study informed the 1989 Children Act. But there were similar results in many other countries subsequent to this study, that the quality of childcare affects development. The biggest effects were in the first 3 years of her language development, and those children with good language development then go on to do better in literacy and most educational outcomes. What about 3 years plus? Well, in the UK, we did this study called EPI, it later became EPSI, it stands for Early Effective Preschool and Primary Education, but then when they went to secondary school, we called it Effective Preschool, Primary and Secondary Education. And in this study, we followed over 3,000 children from around England. And we picked them up at age three from every kind of group setting which existed in age three in England. Nursery classes, play groups, private day nurseries, nursery schools, local authority day nurseries, integrated centres which later became children's centres, and some of the children stayed at home and didn't have any kind of preschool experience at all. And we collected data back from the birth of the child, all the childcare they received in the early years, and then when they were three, we did developmental assessments on the children, we interviewed the families about what was happening in the home, what were the characteristics of the family. We followed the children into their childcare settings, and we examined the quality of the interactions they had in those settings. We followed them through into school, regularly doing developmental assessments of the children, and also collecting data on the schools that they were in. What did we find? Well, I'm going to summarize roughly 100 papers in a few slides. Okay. First of all, at the start of school, the zero line here represents the level of performance of the home group who didn't have any preschool experience. Now, some of our children had 1 to 2 years of preschool experience, and this is how many months of developmental advantage they had over the home group. But another group had an extra year of preschool. They had 2 to 3 years of preschool experience, and they do even better still. Now, the blue is low quality, the red is average quality, and the green is high quality. So we see that both the duration of their preschool experience and the quality of their preschool experience both affect their outcomes at the start of school. And this is true whether it's literacy outcomes or numeracy outcomes or social development. Now, at age seven, every child in England takes the same standardized assessment on literacy and numeracy. And we got the scores for our children on these assessments. And this solid line is the preschool group. This dotted line is the no preschool group. And here we have children from professional families, here we have children from skilled families, and here we have children from unskilled social class families. And you see that all of these social class groups are all showing a pronounced benefit from preschool. However, this line too is the expected minimum level of performance for any seven-year-old. A child who's below that level is regarded as having special needs in some sense, okay? So what we see is that for the children from professional families with preschool, they're well above it, and also without preschool, they're doing very well. Skilled families, well above it with preschool, just above it without preschool. But the unskilled families, above it with preschool, but below the critical line without preschool. So while all of those children are benefiting in a similar way from their preschool experiences, the consequences for the unskilled group, the disadvantaged families, are much more profound. Because being below the line, they're much more likely to be kept down in school for these special needs, etc., etc. Okay. Now, as the children are developing over time, we have a wide range of information about these children. We have data on the children, gender, birth weight, ethnicity, second language. family factors like social class, parent education, family size. The home learning environment, these are based upon questions we asked the parents about what was happening in the home, about opportunities for learning in the home. Then we have the preschool, the duration and quality of preschool. Then we have the primary school and the secondary school. And what we did for the schools is we collected data from national assessments on all the children in the country at the start of school and also at the end of school. And by looking at some social class parameters like poverty status, etc., we were able to analyze which schools were producing achievement for their pupils which was above expectation or below expectation or as expected. And this was a measure of the effectiveness, as it were, of those schools. So we had low effective and average effective and high effective primary schools and similarly for secondary schools. And we could look at an outcome like literacy or numeracy or sociability or behavior problems. And because we have a very large sample, over 3,000 children, we can look at the, how these factors function to affect these outcomes in a simultaneous way. Okay, what do we find? Well, at age 11, every child in the country takes standardized assessments in literacy and numeracy. And these are the results for the children in our study. There's a distinct effect of family income, both on literacy and numeracy, or other things controlled for. The biggest effect is for mother's education. This is the effect of a mother having a degree versus having no qualifications at all, both for literacy and numeracy, a very big effect. Then we have the effect for fathers, about half that of mothers. Okay, so we all know who's important in home. Okay. Then we have the effect of socioeconomic status, quite a strong effect. Then we have the effect of the home learning environment, a very powerful effect for literacy, and also a very strong effect for numeracy. Now, we measured the home learning environment at various ages, but it was always the home learning environment measured at 3 years of age, which had the strong effects on later outcomes. That is the early childhood environment. Then we have the effect of going to a high quality preschool versus no preschool. Strong effect for literacy, but an even stronger effect for numeracy. Then we have the effect of going to a low effective primary school or a high effective primary school, literacy and numeracy. And we see here clearly the preschool is exerting effects on these children's development 6 years after they left the preschool. But also notice, look at the relative size of the preschool effect versus the primary school effect. They're almost identical. Yet the average child in this study had been to a preschool for 18 months. They'd all been to a primary school for 6 years. Okay. But it wasn't just educational outcomes. It was social outcomes as well which were affected. And I give a couple of examples here. This is self-regulation and pro-social behavior measured at 11 and 14. Self-regulation, being able to control their behavior, get over being upset easily, etc. Low quality, average quality, high quality preschool. A very distinct effect, controlling for all other factors on that aspect of social behavior. Pro-social behavior, sharing, showing empathy towards other children. Again, a very clear quality effect, many years after they've left the preschool. Then at 16, which at that time was the school leaving, the end of compulsory schooling, we have the GCSEs given to all children in the country. And these are the literacy and numeracy scores from those. And here we see family income. It's increased in size, particularly for literacy. This is primarily because, I believe, that the rich parents are buying tutoring for their children because they realize the importance of these GCSE examinations. Then we have the mother's education effect, a bit less than it was earlier, but still a very powerful effect. Father's education about the same, socioeconomic status about the same. Home learning environment, much as it was earlier, a bit less powerful than it was earlier, but still a very powerful effect. 13 years later. Then we have the effect of a high-quality preschool on literacy and numeracy, and we see the effects are very similar to what they were earlier at age 11. The effects for the preschool have been maintained over time. With regard to the primary school, the literacy effect of the primary school has disappeared, but it still has an effect for numeracy. And then we have strong effects associated with going to a less effective or a highly effective secondary school, which reflects the secondary schools in England, which some of which are extremely good and some of which are terrible. Okay? So we see these effects of the early environment, both in terms of the home learning environment and the preschool, being carried forward many years later. Now, of course, these children, as they go forward, are going to be affected by their GCSE performance in terms of whether they get to university, what jobs they'll then go on to, et cetera, et cetera. Now, we have measures of a similar kind at different ages. For example, 3 years, 5 years, 6 years, 7 years, 10 years, 11 years. And so what we could do is plot how these 3,000 children change in their scores from 3 years to 5 years to 6 years to 7 years and so on up to 11 years. And if I did that for 3,000 children, you'd see a mass of crisscrossing lines across the page and you wouldn't be able to make head nor tail of it. However, we can do what's called a group trajectory analysis, which basically says, okay, for all of these 3,000 children, are there general patterns which emerge which fit most of the children in the study? And when we did that, we found that there were 6 prototypical trajectories which more or less fitted most of the children in the study. Some of the children start off very high. This is the average. Zero is the average going across there. Some of the children started off 1 standard deviation above the average, and then they stayed more or less there all the way along. Then we had other children who were almost as high, who started very high, but then they fall off to be about average. Then we have 2 big groups who start off around average, and then one of the groups climbs up and is consistently above average, and one falls off and is consistently below average. Then we have 2 groups who start off very low. One of these groups climbs up to about average and stays that way. Another group starts low and just stays low and gets even lower over time. Now, there's a couple of lessons we can learn from this. One is, some of these trajectories are favorable. You'd like your child to be in group 6, or maybe group 4, and group 2 is not too bad. They're all high or increasing over time. You wouldn't want your child to be in group 1, or in group 3 where they're falling off over time. So some of these trajectories are favorable, and some of them are unfavorable. We can work out the odds of being in a favorable trajectory versus an unfavorable trajectory for the children in the study. And what do we find? Well, what affects being in a favorable trajectory is having a good home learning environment, having a lot of high quality preschool, and also going to a good primary school. Okay? Those 3 factors are what primarily increase the odds of being in a favorable developmental trajectory. But also, look at this. Suppose I draw a line here. What's happening to the right of that line? Nothing. The children are staying in the same relative positions. All the change is taking place in this preschool period. That indicates that if you want to produce population level change, you have to act in the preschool period, else you're wasting your time. Okay. Now, this study had policy impact in the UK when we produced the findings on the start of school. We had, after a lot of negotiation, we had an act passed which provided a free early childhood education and care place for every child from their 3rd birthday, 15 hours a week, and that was started in 2004. Now, of course, that was passed by a Labour government. But as time went on, we had the recession, and 2008. But with the recession, there were lots of public service cuts. preschool was kept. Okay. 2010, a Conservative-led government comes to power on a cost-cutting agenda. They cut public spending by 20%. Preschool was untouched. Not only that, 2013, as the economy started to pick up, they increased the offer by giving a free early childhood education care place from the second birthday onwards, from 2 years onwards, gained 15 hours a week, for the 40% most deprived in the country. It's almost half the population. Okay, think about this. That's a Conservative-led government. Now, 2015, May of this year, we have another election. Labour, in their manifesto, promised, oh, we're going to increase the 15 hours a week to 25 hours a week. Within 24 hours, the Conservative Party come back, we're going to increase it to 30 hours a week. And they did, and that's what they did. They passed the Act last week. And as of September 2016, the 15 hours a week will increase to 30 hours a week. We also had an increase in maternity leave, increased to 1 year, from 5 months up to 1 year, paid for the first 9 months, although many employers also pay the extra 3 months. So, and then we have a new early years curriculum for the whole country. We have new training programs for early years staff, and we have an acceptance by all political parties that early years is part of state responsibilities. Now, it's not just evidence from the UK, although I would say that the evidence in the UK is amongst the best in the world. Well, I would say that, wouldn't I? But the OECD also say it. If we look in other countries, Norway, France, Switzerland, all of these countries have national databases, and they also introduced a form of preschool education somewhere around the 70s, region by region across the country. So some economists in those countries got the national data, and knowing the date of birth of the child and the region the child was born in, they were able to work out which children got preschool and which didn't. They then followed these children right through to adulthood. And what they found was, in adulthood, the children who had preschool had better educational qualifications, better employment, and higher incomes. Therefore, they're going to be paying more taxes. So the government's going to win in that respect. Denmark's an interesting case. Denmark, they have registers. They know everything about you. They know your birth weight. They know what hospital you were born in. They know your immunization record. They know your illnesses. They know who your doctor was. They know what childcare you went to, which center, etc. They know what school you went to. They know all your educational records, all your health records, they know your income tax records, they know your employment records, and, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. They also have that registers for the centres themselves. They know which staff work in which centre, what the qualification levels of those staff, and who moves from staff, et cetera, et cetera. So a woman called Bauchmuller in the Danish Statistical Office took this data and matched the data on the children to the data on the centres that the children went to. And she calculated a measure of quality for these centres, like staff-child ratio, training levels of staff, turnover of staff. And what she found was that those children who went to the higher quality centres at age 16 had better educational outcomes than the children who went to the lower quality centres. Okay? Now, this is great, because this is the whole population of Denmark. There's no possibility of any bias in the sampling or anything like that, because it's the whole population. Okay, in Northern Ireland, we repeated the EPI study, and we found essentially the same results. And in Northern Ireland, we found that grades in English at age 11 were increased by 2.4 times for children who had high-quality preschool, and for maths, their grades were increased by 3.4 times. What that means is, two children, equally disadvantaged, One child you give no preschool to. The other child you give high quality preschool. This child will be 3.4 times more likely to get a high grade in maths than this child. Okay? Think about the educational and employment and economic consequences of increasing your education levels of your children in that way. I think you'll start to see that this has profound economic consequences. Okay, we also see benefits in preschool in Asia and South America in studies in places like Bangladesh, Uruguay, Argentina, have all found data and results very similar to what I've been telling you for those other countries. Here's a study illustrating the long-term effect from England. In England, they have a random sample of about 15,000 children born in 1958. They follow these children right through to adulthood. They're now in their 50s, these children. And they look, and these people looked at their cognition and socialization. And they found that controlling for child, family, and neighborhood factors, there were long-lasting effects from preschool education, in that those children who'd gone to preschool versus those who hadn't had better cognitive scores at 7-16. In adulthood, age 33, their preschool was found to increase educational qualifications, employment levels, and earnings at age 33. Okay. PISA results. 15-year-olds who attend a preschool across the developed countries who belong to OECD were on average a year ahead of those who had not. Widening access to pre-primary education can improve both overall performance and equity by reducing socioeconomic disparities among students if extending coverage does not compromise quality. What's coming across over and over again is this message: it's the amount of preschool that makes a difference, and also the quality of the preschool that makes a difference. And the effects are long-lasting. So the gains from early childhood education and care are in terms of educational achievement improved, special education and grade repetition reduced, behavior problems, delinquency and crime are reduced, employment, earnings and welfare dependency improved, smoking, drug use and depression are reduced, which in turn leads to savings to government in terms of schooling costs, social service costs, crime costs, healthcare costs. In different countries, you'll find different calculations of what is the ratio of those savings to costs. But what's interesting, in every single case where people have worked it out, it's always positive. There's always a significantly increased savings over the costs. The trouble is, to get those savings, you have to wait 10 years, and then longer, because it's not until that time that the savings start to flow through. Now, unfortunately, elections take place much sooner than 10 years, and politicians often only think as far ahead as the next election. And I think it's to Jay Weatherall's credit that he's thinking way ahead of the next election. He's thinking about the long-term future of the children, not only of South Australia, but all of Australia. And that's where we are, that the costs of preschool are way outweighed by the savings to government. And the savings after 10 years then just get bigger and bigger and bigger over time. Okay. Now, the lessons we have here, the early years are very important. Early childhood education and care is part of the infrastructure for a successful society. Several societies around the world are now increasing their expenditure on early childhood with the specific aim that they're going to increase the education levels of their populations and the skill levels of their workforce in future years, because they want to increase their economic development and increase their standing in the economic league tables of the world. For example, China aims to be the economic superpower by 2050. Who's shown the biggest increase in spending in early childhood in the last 50 years? China. And you see that in other countries as well. Now, so high quality early childhood education and care boosts development. We should also remember parenting is also very important. In all of our studies, we always find the effects of parenting are about double that of the effects of the early childhood education and care that we provide for children. Early childhood education care lifts the whole population curve, but disadvantaged children in particular benefit greatly from high quality early childhood education and care. And if you have limited resources in terms of limited high quality staff, limited high quality settings, I would plan to put those high quality resources in areas where the most disadvantaged children are. Because working with disadvantaged children place special demands upon staff, and those children will benefit the most from the high quality. Of course, we all hope that every child is going to get high quality, and we'll work towards that. But inevitably, that's a developmental process that will take some years to fully achieve. Okay. I'm going to finish there. And if you want to look at references, there they all are. Thank you.